So the book, what I'm going to do is just hopefully fairly briefly say what I try to do in the book, and then it would be great to have some questions, some discussion. The book works in three sections. I hope it works. It's structured in three sections. The first looks at the long history of fire in the Cape, and it starts in prehistory, and I say relatively briefly, so from about 1.5 million years ago, there've been hominins and then humans here, and they've been using fire, so hunter-gatherers used fire for hunting, for burning grass, attracting animals, for cooking, those things. And then really things step up with the arrival of the Khoikhoi herders coming down from further north, and they start burning regularly for grazing. And they also push the hunter-gatherer people up into the mountains, who start burning up there, so they change the fire regimes up there somewhat. We think that they didn't have any major impacts, but we don't really know, because most of the place they were burning was Rhenosterfeld, and that's now under Bokomo grain and other cereals and things like that. So we're not sure. But certainly when Van Riebeck pitched up, it was pretty nerve-wracking. You know, large groups of Khoikhoi arrived with thousands of animals annually, and they would burn. They would graze, and then they'd, well, not throw a match, but you know what I mean, and they would push off. And of course all the buildings were flammable, and this was pretty scary. Van Riebeck actually took to planting rows of sweet potatoes around his crops to try and keep these fires out. And there's a long history of the VOC, the Dutch East India Company, trying to regulate fire use. They didn't try and ban it, but they tried to control it. And clearly, if you follow the regulations right the way through to 1795, it didn't succeed. I mean, 1687, they threatened hanging for the second offense for burning. In the 1740s, they tried again with really serious punishment. So obviously, farmers carried on burning. And so the kind of opposition, or the people who needed controlling, were mainly around the Cape. They thought the soils were marvelous, all these lovely flowers came, sort of free burgers and grow vegetables. And really what they ended up doing was doing quick return vegetables and stock farming. And they learned from the Khoikhoi to burn seasonally. And they also tried to burn to get rid of rhinoceros, actually. So the early, we know this because the early explorers, botanical and scientific explorers, Anders Sparman and those people, made a lot of observations of the burning practices in those times. And for instance, Sparman noted that this burning rhinoceros actually seemed to encourage it. So some interesting early observations of burning here. The Dutch period, I won't go into it too much. I mean, the first fire department was set up in 1691 here. So there's a long history of trying to deal with this. There was a major slave set Cape Town on fire in 1735. They were caught. They were horribly tortured. They had a commando who rode around here throwing, they say grenades, I don't know what that meant, into gullies, trying to get rid of undesirable people who could cause these sorts of problems. And that changed the architecture. So these sort of flat-topped, sealed roofs came in because of after the 1735 fire. Certainly people who were better off got rid of thatch and did these flat roofs. But so as everyone here probably does know, the British arrive in 1795, go away, come back in 1806. And really, they took over many of these practices. They inherited the Dutch almanacs, which included advice on when to burn. But I think the key thing I want to say about the British period was really this focus they had on timber. So the Royal Navy needed timber, and they were concerned at the lack of it. And even the Dutch had worried all the time about lack of firewood and wagons, and started importing wood from southern Cape and further afield. But this lack of timber generated real anxiety, and then there were huge fires in the 1860s, a legendary fire in 1869, which killed, I think it was around 30, 31 people, but farms and huge area destroyed, and this led to a debate. So we had a, I say now as a blooming Brit, there was a legislative assembly here, and they set up an inquiry, and they decided we needed to have professional forestry here in the Cape and start planting plantations. And the major concern then was the risk of fire to plantations. And you have John Crombie Brown, the Scotsman who was the colonial botanist, German Ludwig Papp before him, and they were real, with Old Testament zeal, they thundered against fire. It was the great evil. And the narrative of the time was fire dries out the land. So it's dry because, and there were big droughts in the 1840s and 1860s, and this was because of fire. And Cape Town was running out of water, and the solution was plant trees all over the mountain. And you know, the reason you have a summer drought here is because there's not a forest on Table Mountain. So they did all of this. And there was a huge fight about this in the 1889. A chap called David Hutchins oversaw the planting on Table Mountain. It was a huge fight, and the city authorities insisted that actually these trees were a menace. They were a fire risk, and they were actually drying up the water. And they won the day in the end. So they took the trees off the top, put in reservoirs. But I think, so the important legacy of the Brits was a professional forestry department. Interestingly enough, they got in a Frenchman to run it, who's arrived, very flamboyant hire. He arrived here in 1880, he didn't speak a word of English. He arrived with his sword and his uniform from, you know, French National Forestry Department guy. A real character, I mean, but he had this, the Frank desiccation, the problem is fire drying out, the answer to everything is trees. So you have this narrative coming into the 20th century very strongly that the point of view of hydrology, and of course we needed the trees. This was a country where mining was expanding and railways were being built, and we did need the timber. So that's a whistle stop tour of section one.